Need to create a complex enterprise Angular application? Angular Bootcamp is an intensive 3-day workshop class to learn the basics of Angular through sophisticated techniques for real-world applications. We target Angular 6 and the recent versions, with much of the curriculum is suitable back to Angular 2. Or go beyond the 3-day class with a consultation or project launch with Oasis Digital, the team behind Angular Bootcamp. We can assist your team or launch your project with advanced Angular topics including scalability, data flow, state management, full stack product design, and more. Contact us for a private class at your location or buy a ticket for public classes in various cities around the U.S. and occasionally in Europe. Online live instructor training is also available at angularbootcamp.com.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to Adventures in Angular. Today, I'm your host, Aaron Frost, and we have a first-time co-host, panelist, Brian Love. Say hi, Brian.
Hey, what's up?
Yeah. And we have our today's guest, Amir. So, Amir, can you say hi and introduce yourself to everybody?
Yeah. Hi, guys. Basically, I'm a full-stack developer. I'm working mainly with Angular, but I also have some experience working with React and Redux. Currently, I'm working for a company called Logs.io. It's a company that provides an intelligent log analysis that combines the ELK stack with some advanced algorithms and machine learning to help organizations and companies to extract valuable insights from their mostly unreadable logs. Now, if some of you are unfamiliar with the ELK stack, I recommend to look it up on Google. It's really a big buzzword in the log analysis field.
And that's what you spend your days there, huh?
Yeah.
Mostly. And your nights?
Almost every night.
Oh, yeah.
He's committed.
He is committed. So before we dive into what Amir is here to talk about, I'm going to back up a second, and I want Brian to introduce himself. Brian's a friend of mine. He's a new GDE. He got his recently, but go ahead and introduce yourself, Brian. The listeners haven't met you before, so go ahead.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm the CTO. That's Chief Technology Officer for Brebug. We're an Angular consulting firm in Denver, Colorado. We have a lot of big clients here in the Front Range, and we have the pleasure of working with Aaron occasionally as well. And I just became a GDE in Angular like 2 weeks ago, I think, October 12th, maybe.
Yeah.
So happy to be here.
Cool, man. So just for the listeners' sake again, what does CTO stand for again?
Chief Technology Officer.
Gotcha.
So basically,
Some of them might not know.
Yeah, fair enough. So I oversee all the engineers at our company and help guide the technology and, you know, kind of architect a lot of our software that we're doing for clients.
Cool, man. Well, awesome. So everybody, that's Brian. On Twitter, you are at BLove, or what's your...
It's at @Brian_Love.
@Brian_Love. Okay. So if you want to chat with Brian on Twitter, it's @Brian_Love. So, okay. Amir, you are the guest of honor. Everyone's here because of you. What are we here to talk about today, man?
I want to talk about, let's say that you alone receive a project to build a web application, a whole web application. How do you approach that, and how do you start? Where do you end? What do you do? That's what I want to talk about.
That's what we're here. All right. What? That's a lot, dude. It's a lot.
That is a lot.
That is a lot.
That's basically more than one podcast. So we're going to have to keep this high level.
Yeah, of course. Yeah,
we have to stay out of the weeds, otherwise we're never going to finish. So, exactly. So I read one of your recent blogs. You published it last week about cross-field validators. I actually had just barely done the same thing a few days before I read your blog. I thought it was funny. I mean, you solved it the exact same way, and we were solving the exact same problem. So
that's cool.
So yeah, I recently met you through your blog right before we had a podcast together. So starting your own app, why don't you give us some of your ideas on this, Amir?
I recently had a side project. I needed to build a stock management platform, and I also had a few challenges aside from making the application from scratch. Because I received an old application and I had to build my new application to coexist with the old one. That is, they both share the same database. They both have to share their data. So I somehow need to create a new application with new technologies and still stay backward compatible with the old system, specifically with MySQL database. Mm-hmm. But basically, what I want to talk about is how do you even approach to choose a database? How do you create layers? If you create layers, create multiple microservices. So that's the project that I worked on. And my first question was, how do you choose the tape for the client? We basically want to know, see, to give the customer what he wants, what he will see. So how do you choose the client-side technology? Will you choose Angular? Will you choose React? Will you choose Vue? Will you choose anything else that is in the market right now? And how do you do that? Have you done that research in your companies?
Yeah, and it's, I think it kind of changes a little bit per company. I'm kind of biased, but here's a fact. I used to work on a giant team and like 60 people all committing on the same single page app. So it was a big team. And we were using AngularJS 1.5. And I think they're still using that. And what I know about that is that it worked and is not the, it, we all know it's not the fastest framework. It's actually not the easiest to maintain either, but we all know, I mean, it worked. And so at a certain level, I think they all work. And if anyone tried to say to me, this one prevents me from doing what I need to do, I would kind of laugh at them.
Yeah, I'd be really surprised if you can't do what you need to do in any of those three, right?
Like if someone told me, I got to go to Vue because React doesn't do the thing I need to do, I'd be like, what? What?
What are you doing?
Yeah, what are you trying to do? Doing? Yeah. The React doesn't fulfill that need. Like I don't think that you're right. I think you're wrong. I think you're being hyperbolic, and I think you're using extreme cases as a norm. But I don't know. So at a certain level, I think they're all fine, and you can accomplish what you need. Because let's be honest, we all accomplish cool stuff with jQuery plugins. I mean, we had no framework, right?
Like, that's right.
So we don't need a framework necessarily to do cool stuff. And so when people tell me framework stopping them, I'm like, well, I agree to disagree. You just need to think about it differently. But inside that, everything's probably fine. I have some biases that steer me towards Angular. So, but I every company's different. So Amir, what do you think? What are some of the things you use to decide?
I actually don't have preferences or configurations. I just try to build some applications with the technologies and see how it goes, how easy it is to create components, to create a simple application, to run with it, to create some more complex things. And then I choose the more scalable and maintainable framework.
Do you think that one framework is more scalable or maintainable than the other?
Not necessarily. Let's say in React, you create the component with everything inside one file, right? You have only one JSX file with everything in it, CSS, HTML, and JavaScript.
Yeah.
So it's really easy to split your code into real small components, and you do it really easily. And if you go to Angular, you have to separate every component to CSS file, HTML file, JavaScript or TypeScript file. Also, you'll have to create modules and more overhead. And I think that's a little bit consideration, a small consideration from maintaining, creating, like how easy it is to create the application, especially if it's a big one.
Sure, but like in Angular, you can put it all in one file if you want, right? I mean, you don't have to have a template file and a CSS file or SAS or whatever you're doing, right? You can put it all in line. Right, Aaron, you do that.
But then you're not using the Angular abilities. And Angular is really, really powerful with shadow DOMing and splitting of concerns. And I think it will be a little bit.
So when I write Angular components, when I generate them, I do inline styles and inline templates because one of the things that I learned from React is that I like my code and my style
really close. right?
Yeah, I like my HTML and my style in the same file as my component. And so granted, there's differences between the two, but I did learn that. Like, I like that about that. I like single file components.
Sure.
And I think that that's important to have single file components. Single file components promotes getting frustrated if it gets too big and then you have to break it out into a smaller file, like, which is what you should be doing anyway. But when you put it all in one file and it's like, oh, dude, this is 500 lines long. It's like, yeah, it's time to make
components. Deconstruct it into more, you know,
components. Yeah, exactly. Multiple at that point. 500 is huge. So that's, I don't know. That's one of the things I like.
But to Amir's point, I mean, he also brought up module. What were you kind of thinking there, Amir, in terms of like modules versus like React and Vue? As far as I'm aware, they don't have this concept of a module. Is that right?
Not that I'm aware of. But again, I'm not that an expert in React and not especially not in Vue. So I'm afraid I cannot answer this.
I think in React and Vue, you have the word module for them means what it means in JavaScript, which is
an ES6 module.
You have a file that exports.
Yeah, they don't have an ng module.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so, or an equivalent. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so considering, I have my opinion here, and I shared it earlier this week, and actually I was talking with Joe, who's normally a panelist on the show, and he made a good point, which is on a certain level, we're all kind of all of the front end frameworks are kind of the same. Like, yeah, you do them differently, but you're getting the kind of the same thing. And like Angular prescribes way more of the options for you, whereas React lets you pick, and you can pick some of the other pieces that go into the stack, right? But 80% of the people are picking the same pieces, and so for most people, it's like it's as prescribed as an Angular, and Vue is very similar, their community anyway. And there's some people on the edges of all three of those that are picking non, like, community standard libraries, right?
Yeah.
And so what he said was, like, if for Angular, it's basically like saying, hey, you have to pick to ride this kind of a bike. You have to pick a Schwinn, right? But in like a React or a Vue, they're like, well, you can pick the Schwinn or you can pick the Huffy, right? And everyone's like, well, I'm gonna pick this Schwinn. And everyone's like, dude, look, I got a Schwinn, right? And at the end of the day, the choice that you got was, it meant something, right? And not being forced meant something to some people. And that's an intangible that some people really appreciate. I will say the nuance of that is lost on me. And having been on teams where people take that freedom and pick the Huffy and totally destroy the app, I don't appreciate, and I don't think management does regularly appreciate people's innovations, like creating things that already existed. Like imagine if someone was like, hey, none of the frameworks do what we want, we got to build our own. Like at a certain level, like there's an extreme, like that's the extreme of none of them work, I better build my own. But some people like to chop things up and make their own versions of them. And it's like, really, should you be doing that? Does your boss really want to own one of those when there's a perfectly good open source community maintained version? You know, like, I don't know. So I don't appreciate the freedom necessarily, just because it will be used and it will usually be used incorrectly.
So basically what you mean here is it doesn't matter which technology you use. They all do the same thing and will just affect the way you write the application.
Yeah, your patterns and practices are huge. What do you think, Brian?
Yeah, I think that's generally true. I mean, I think, you know, if we're talking about the three popular frameworks out there right now, I think they get a lot of the same feature sets, right? The way you do it might be differently, whether that's with dependency injection or importing modules and kind of how you build things. But one of the reasons why perhaps my tendency is towards Angular is I like the opinionated approach to a framework, right? So if I'm going to use an HTTP client or, you know, I need to do an HTTP request, you know, with React, I've got to basically go out there and figure out which one I want to, you know, which one I want to use and which one I'm going to bet on, so to speak, that it's going to be a long-term viable option for my application. Now, I would say, like you said, Aaron, I think most people tend to pick the same one, right? So whether that's Axios or whatever it is in the React community. But I like the opinionated aspect of Angular. And I do think you get a lot of the same, you know, change detection, you know, components and, you know, properties and whether we call them, you know, whether they're called props or whether they're called inputs or whatever you want to call it, right? I mean, you're getting a lot of the same feature set, I think. And I think it probably comes down to a lot of personal preference in terms of which one you kind of follow the most, so, or use the most.
Yeah, I agree. So yeah, what else you got for us, Amir?
Let's talk a little bit about the UI.
Okay.
Have you ever had to design a UI for someone, or maybe you received a design from a designer and there was something missing and you had to like tweak things? How do you choose what to put in the UI? There is, how do you build the UI for the user that will be the nicest and simplest and the most comfortable for him?
Don't you just use Bootstrap so it looks like every other website out there?
Yeah, but you still have to create the page, right? You have the components, but you have to put them in places and make it look sleek.
Yeah.
So how do you do that? How do you start thinking about the layout?
Yeah, that's a good question. How have you kind of tackled this problem?
I've created many versions of time. I started to create something. I ran along with it. So it actually goes somewhere that I don't really like and started from scratch. I had to say, but I had to start again just because it doesn't really feel right. That's me.
I'm kind of the enemy of the starting over thing. When I read a lot of the parts of Lean Startup, I realized, yeah, that's that stuff identifies with me. And as I worked at a big company, one of the things I noticed was you had a lot of engineers who could start a project, right? Really, any engineer can start a project. Am I right? Like any engineer can say, yeah, I'll start this piece. But I realized, you know, only the most expert and choice team members have what it takes to get them and their team to actually ship a feature. And I mean fully ship it, not just like get it 80% of the way there and it's good enough and like let's just get it out the door. But I mean like the last 20 yards as well, not just the first, not just the first 80, but the final 20, right? And I think it takes a lot of poised decision making to say, I want to rewrite this, but I'm not going to right now. I think that's a senior level decision sometimes to be like, listen, this does need to be rewritten. I know 100 things now I didn't know when I wrote this, but I still need to ship this code. Like I still have to ship this product. So I'm gonna postpone my internal want to rewrite. So I've always kind of been a bigger fan of not rewriting as much as possible and taking what you got and moving on. But that precludes, I mean, that you started with good patterns and practices. If you started with bad patterns and practices, well, then you're going to have to rewrite before you get to the finish line anyway. Like, there's no way. So that's why I kind of like what you said, Brian. I like the prescriptions from Angular and like it is very opinionated. I like that opinion because it helps you start right. And it gives you less ability to deviate, which is, I think, valuable. So, yeah. But, I mean, there's so many aspects to that question, Amir. Like, how do you do your CSS? Like, are you using SAS? Are you using BEM?
That's not what I'm talking about. Actually, let's take, for example, material design.
Okay.
They say mostly that if you have a main action in the page, you'll put the floating button to the side, to the bottom side. Correct?
Yep. Yeah.
Then it's one less thing to think about. You actually have the main action floating for the user everywhere. So things like that, how do you create the layout for the user in the page? That's the design I'm talking about. I'm not talking about actual inner technologies, whether I use Pub, Pub.js or SAS, LESS, or things like that.
Is your job search stuck? Maybe you're not getting any interviews with employers, or maybe you are, but no job offers. Or you may be new and not even know where to start. This is Charles Max Wood, and I'm releasing a new course and ebook on how to find a job as a software developer. The course walks you through the process of finding the types of companies you want to work for, getting their attention, and putting your best foot forward as the candidate they want. I've coached dozens of developers in looking for jobs and have been able to help several people find jobs within 2 weeks to 2 months. So whether you're new to development, can't find a great job that fits what you want, or are looking for remote work from an area without a strong tech community, I can help. Go to getacoderjob.com and sign up today.
So how do you make those decisions, Amir? So in this application that you had to kind of do a rewrite on, you know, how do you approach that decision?
I mostly look through web pages out there in the internet, and I get inspiration. I see something I like, I try to think what I like there, how can I apply it in my design, and start sketching things and see, okay, I have this component, will I have this component built in a library, let's say Angular material, and if not, what can I do how long will it take, how much resources will it take to create such a component? Do I need a substitute for now? That's mostly what I do until I get prototype. And here I have a decision to make, whether I go with it and start to type, to code, and to run with it. And I have the risk that something will not match, not fit. Or maybe I just go and fine-tune this prototype and make it an actual screenshot-like. That's mostly what I do.
Huh.
Interesting. So are you, like, using a tool? Are you using, like, Sketch or something to come up with your initial kind of UI design? Or are you just going right at, you know, kind of prototyping things out with material?
For the mock-upping, I'm using Balsamic Mockup.
Okay.
And it really helps creating the basic layout. I need a button here, I need it there, a title. Yep. I don't really care about how it looks. Like, I need to know what will I have in the UI. What will the user be able to click and to interact with? And later I can either use Sketch to actually put components, material components or other components to look like the material components to actually receive a picture that is as close to real as can be.
So yeah, I like the wireframing step, like the balsamic mockup thing.
Yep.
I think it's a good step. I just worked on a project recently where the client had a designer, right, a UX, and the UX person was in charge of working with the client to get the mocks like made and like approved. And then once it was approved, the designer would then create all the HTML and CSS for those features. And so I actually got spoon-fed HTML, like fully formed, like perfect to mock HTML and CSS.
I'm not familiar with that. How do you receive HTML and CSS for the design? Do you take the code and put it inside components, or do you receive it? No, you don't
receive
any components, right?
No, so like the designer would take the entire screen and he'd build the entire screen with just HTML and CSS. Then he'd give it to me and I'd have to take it, chop it up into components, yep, make sure all the CSS still got applied, conditionally put on like error tags and like show and hide some things, given it an error state or not. But I essentially got like the whole like HTML CSS framing given to me, and then I just had to wrap it up inside of components and you know, like componentize it. And so Mez, it was actually,
dude,
it went amazing. Like after that, I'm like, dude, I don't ever want to have to write the CSS issue. I was able to just focus on routes and components and reusability.
The Angular stuff. Yeah.
That's what's here. Yeah. So,
yeah. All yeah. Directives, whatever you need. Yeah.
Yeah. Man, it was actually really, really nice. So that was one of the funner things I've done recently. But
I suppose it also depends on the quality of what you're getting back from your designer too, right? I mean, you know, I've seen people kind of maybe use Photoshop to like slice up a thing and gen out some HTML and whatever. And you're just like, what am I going to do with this? You know? So hopefully if the HTML that you're getting back from your designer is quality and works well for you, then I can say there's a lot of value in that.
Yeah. There's so much that goes into building an app from scratch. I will say this. It sounds to me like Amir is like 10 levels above me when it comes to formulating your own design. I'm just not a good designer. Like, you know, I think it's valuable to accept your strengths and your weaknesses. And I'm just not a designer, straight up. I'm not.
Me neither.
I can take a design that's given to me and I can make an app that looks like that. But to have a concept of what looks good, man, I got nothing. Like I'm literally just, I just stare at a screen and I don't even know what to start doing. Like it's crazy. So I really, really, really appreciate having team members that can design as well as a solid designer, because I'm so worthless at it.
So do you don't write CSS and the HTML for your features for your application? Working in a team.
Yeah.
Are you writing only the logic side of the application, having to write a few components on the logic side, and then someone else will write the HTML and CSS side?
Only on the most recent project. I've never had a project like this most recent one before. And really, the designer didn't own the HTML and CSS. He just initially wrote it and then gave it to me. And then from then on out, I own it. Like, it's in components, and the designer is not going to know how to update that because he's not an Angular engineer. So if he needs updates to his design post his handoff to me, I got to go and make those changes. But in the past, I've always, you know, probably like most engineers, you just get a design, whether it's a sketch or even a PNG, and you just got to make it look like that, you know?
Yep.
You got to make things that look like what you're given. And so then that's what most of my career has been, is that I've never had a scenario where, like this last project, where I don't have to write the HTML and CSS. It was actually pretty nice. So I will say HTML and CSS got, for me, like 762 times easier once Flexbox came around. But
prior to 762, exactly.
Like precise.
63.
I rounded. No, there's a fraction. There's a decimal. I know it, but I didn't say it. Flexbox really, for me, changed how much easier it is to lay down some tracks and get an app that looks good. Because without that, man, it's a nightmare for me. I realize there's some people that are
breaks and all that stuff.
Oh, jeez. Absolutely, man. Positioned rubbish. And
relative positioning.
Get out. Yeah, exactly. So, you know, the design side of like the laying down the tracks for HTML just got a lot easier once I started working on projects that didn't have to support non-Flexbox enabled browsers.
Which thankfully is very little now. So
IE.
So
well, even IE11 has Flexbox support, right? So you're good.
Yeah.
What do you do with tables? Tables do not support Flex layout.
That's don't. Really,
that's a bummer.
Yeah, it is. I suppose if I really had like heavy needs for a table, I may look and see if CSS grid would solve some of my problems. But otherwise, I'd probably just use a styled table. For an actual tabular data, I'd probably just use a table.
I'd probably just use like AG grid or materials or something like that.
There you go. Yeah. So a lot of things, like I've used like on this recent project, PrimeNG. Before that, I used Clarity by VMware. Before that, I've used in-house components and material design. Specifically. So pretty much everywhere I've gone when I needed a table, it already existed and I just needed to figure out how to integrate with it. But to the point, I don't spend a lot of my time rebuilding components that exist somewhere else. It's just too expensive. I think it's a fool's errand to own your own component library. Because it's like in Angular, one of the things I love about Angular, why I push people to, is They also own my Webpack build. And when I watch people around the world owning their Webpack build, I think, man, you're crazy. Like, that's, it's ridiculous that you own your Webpack build, because I know how much time it takes to own your Webpack build responsibly. Like, to do an effective, perfect Webpack build is hard.
Yeah.
So I've handed that off, and I'm like, yeah, dude, own that. And the same thing applies here as well. Like, I like that there's component libraries that already exist. Let's hand that off. Let's use those components in our app just so we can focus on building the app the customers want, not the components, right? Because owning components really is, it's where projects can go to die, man. And everyone of my friends who's from Domo, who's listening, is just like shaking their head right now. Like, we owned our own in-house component library, and it's balls, yeah, man. It's a fool's errand. It's just not good.
And keeping it up to date and accessibility. I mean, even if you build it on the CDK, it's still hard, right?
Yeah. And when you want to upgrade Angular or TypeScript or Rx, like, well, dude, are my components going to work? I don't know. Probably not. And so your upgrade just got 10 times harder because you own all the components as well. Like all the component lib, which is what your app's built out of. So I mean, I don't really build tables or modals or dropdowns unless, I mean, rarely there's going to be a need to do that kind of stuff, but yeah.
Yeah, if you've got a really specific requirement that you need to fulfill and you absolutely can't get something out there that does it, then, you know, create a library and bring it in either with Angular 6 workspaces or NX or whatever you're doing, right?
Yeah.
But then you're right, you own it, right? And so...
Yeah, forever. It's technical debt, man. It's in your wheelhouse.
Yeah.
Someone's got to maintain that sucker. So yeah, I totally agree. Let me give you an example of the, you can think I'm crazy, and I'm not going to disagree with you. I will agree with you. Recently a designer gave me a dropdown, but he also told me to use PrimeNG, and the dropdown didn't look like the PrimeNG dropdown, but he still wanted the fly out thing that he could design. So I had the choice of building my own dropdown or telling the designer he has to accept whatever PrimeNG gives him, right? But I took the third option. I made the UI look like what he wanted.
Yeah.
And then I made the drop-down piece of the PrimeNG zero opacity, and I positioned it right on top of the one that I made look like the what he wanted. So when you click on what I made, when you click on what you see, you're actually clicking on the PrimeNG drop-down. It's just opaque zero, right? And so, yeah, then all of a sudden the actual PrimeNG dropdown appears and it works and it functions just like you thought it was going to, but the actual, the closed state of the dropdown looked like what you wanted. So like, I'll go to links, and that was actually so much easier. Like, that was actually one of the easiest ways I could have done that. And so, I think it's really, I'll go to lengths to not acquire new technical debt that we're going to own for like long-term periods. So yeah, I thought that was like an innovative way of cheapening, like keeping high functionally community owned components, but also keeping the look that the customer wanted. You know what I'm saying? Does that make sense?
Yeah, but couldn't you just meddle with the design? If you have all the logic from PrimeNG, can't you just alter the CSS?
If I alter the CSS to make their component look like what I need, then like, let's say the next week I get an update to PrimeNG, right? Or I upgrade the app and all of a sudden they change one of their class names that I was targeting to style this thing, right? And now the style goes back and it reverts to the old style. Well, guess what? Now I'm stuck. I have to go through all my components and retweak them to match and like reselect the new classes for PrimeNG. And so I just said, nah, I'm out. I'm just going to make this thing very, very simple and put the dropdown on top of it, kind of opaque. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's kind of interesting, because remember when Material changed theirs from the prefix from like MD to Matt?
Matt, yeah.
If you had any like CSS, although I think they did a good job. They had a... NPM module that you could install that would like kind of do some of it for you, like a fixed lint type of thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, I get your point there. That's interesting. Yeah, I will say I have used the Matt classes though. Yeah. So yeah. I hope they don't change it again.
We'll send this podcast to Jeremy.
Perfect.
Come on, Jeremy. So, yeah. All right. Yeah. Well, you know, honestly, this topic could go on for a really, really long time. So I'm going to say any last ideas, or we're going to just call it for the week and we'll move on to picks.
Do you run your own freelance business? Or maybe you're thinking about picking up some business on the side. Well, then you need FreshBooks. FreshBooks is the quickest and easiest way to get invoices out to your clients. It's easy to use. It works anywhere, available from any device on the desktop, iPhone, iPad, Android, and all of your data is backed up and secure. And it makes it really easy to get organized and get paid. You'll be tracking time, logging expenses, and invoicing your clients in no time. You can also save time billing, freeing up several days per month to focus on the work that you love, and you get paid faster. FreshBooks customers are paid on average 5 days faster because there's a link on the invoice that says pay me now. And it's a great way to grow your business. Plus, FreshBooks is offering a 30-day trial. That's right, 30-day trial if you try them out. So go to gofreshbooks.com/devchat and enter devchat in the how did you hear about us section. Once again, for a 30-day trial, go to gofreshbooks.com/devchat and enter devchat in the how did you hear about us section.
I'll do picks first. So two picks. I got two picks. The first pick is a movie. I don't normally like movies as much as I like this movie. Like, it really, really got me. And it was called A Star is Born. And it's got Bradley Cooper. It's got Lady Gaga. I'm easily entertained. I like movies regularly. But, man, the day after I watched A Star is Born, like, I woke up at like 2 a.m. because I was just like still into what was happening in the movie. And my brain just was like, dude, you can't go to sleep. You got to solve these issues that the movie presented in your mind. And man, A Star is Born is beautiful. If you get a chance, I highly recommend it. Another thing I'm going to recommend is I found this concept these last few weeks, and it's called, in Angular, you know, we all have to build forms, and in Angular, there's two ways to do forms, right? There's template bit driven forms, and there's reactive forms. Yeah. Well, inside of reactive forms, there's this approach you can take called model driven forms. And I wanted to know what model driven forms were. So I looked at them, and I just wanted to do a shout out for anyone who's using model driven forms, because it feels like the way, way, way easier way to build forms using reactive forms in Angular. So two shouts out, one to the Angular team for reactive forms and model driven forms, and Star is Born. So let's go with Amir. You got some picks?
Yeah, I have two. The first is actually a library I created, and I struggled generating a PDF file. PDF is actually a really, really old format. And it's funny that it's so hard to create a PDF file out of HTML or any web page. So I kind of stumbled upon Puppeteer of Chrome. It's a headless Chrome JavaScript package. And there you can use actually the ability of Chrome to generate a PDF out of a web page. So I created a package that combines the generation of dynamic HTML that gives you create template of the HTML. And you also add some CSS, and then you can generate a PDF file that easy. It's called T-School, like T for school for T. It's actually a little a fun anecdote that T-School in Hebrew, which is my native language, is frustration.
Okay.
So I mean, it just emphasizes the frustration I had until I came up with this solution, until I finally found the Puppeteer package. And that's my first pick. The second one is VS Code extension, which helps you when you have error functions and you want to create them, you have them one line, then for some reason you want to expand them to several lines, you usually put braces.
Yeah, curly braces.
And this extension helps you convert the one-line error function to multiple-line error function in one click.
What's it called?
It's called L function converter. As simple as that.
L?
L function?
Error function converter.
Error function converter. All right. I'll put that in the show notes. Nice. Okay. What else we got?
That's it for me.
All right. Be love. You up?
All right. Cool, man. I got two picks as well. I've been spending a lot of my free time doing two things, basically. I've been really learning a lot about Angular schematics, and I am absolutely hooked on this show called The 100 that came out a couple of years ago. There's like six seasons, so lots and lots of hours of TV for you to watch on Netflix. So if you're into that kind of like post-apocalyptic kind of show, it's pretty cool. So I've been watching a lot of that, and been doing a lot with Angular schematics lately. Just gave a talk here at the Rocky Mountain Angular on it, and heading up to Boulder and then Portland here in a couple of weeks to talk on it as well. And it's really an interesting topic because what's interesting about it is a lot of people are using Angular, are using schematics in the CLI, but the schematics itself really isn't Angular, right? So it's a build tool. And there's it's written in TypeScript. And so it's pretty cool to kind of see how they're doing it with Material or, you know, with the CLI themselves and how to generate components. And it's a really cool tool. You can, you know, write your own schematics. And so that's something that we've kind of been digging into here at Breebug. And it's a lot of fun. It is not Angular, though. So once you get into it, don't be thinking like, oh, I'm going to like create some components and write Angular. It's not Angular really at all. It's its own library, but it's really powerful and helps you to build out modules or components and enforce maybe business logic or enforce practices in your organization by creating these reusable schematic collections. So,
nice. Yeah, man. Schematics and the 100.
Yeah, man.
All right. Sounds good. Okay. Well, thanks for coming, Amir. Appreciate you taking some time to chat with us at Ye Olde Adventures in Angular and with the community. Brian, first time panelist, hats off. And we're gonna sign out. So thanks everybody. Peace.
Bandwidth for this segment is provided by CacheFly, the world's fastest CDN. Deliver your content fast with CacheFly. Visit CacheFly.com to learn more.